just take some minutes to introduce. First of all, to thank Piero. Thanks very much, Piero, for having accepted our invitation to talk about your research in this seminar that we start specifically related to those of you. And I see a lot of familiar faces here in the Zoom of HPC Europa 3 program fellows, which have been here in Barcelona or at least in Spain, using the grant by the HPC Europa program. So thank you, Piero, for being with us, and thanks all of the attendees also to just listen to this talk by Piero Ferrari. Piero Ferrari, he received his master in science degree in physics in the Pontifical Catholic University of Chile back in 2013. Then he obtained his PhD in 2017 at TU Leuven in Belgium. And since then he works there as a postdoctoral researcher, grant awarded by the Research Foundation Flanders, FWO. So he's working specifically in the quantum solid state physics in Leuven. And just to mention that he was awarded, as I said, more than nearly 3 months grant in Barcelona using the Mare Nostrum here at BSC, at the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, and working with Professor Silvia Gomez at the Institute of Theoretical and Computational Chemistry at the University of Barcelona. And today he will present his talk about, with the title, I am sorry if I just don't pronounce it perfectly, but determining the magnetic order of con plus n minus 5 clusters by using multi-configurational calculations. You will, of course, you are the experts and you know more than me, but I guess that the study of this, the magnetism of transition metal clusters is really a matter of research. And especially, I would say, the advancements of this science, of this specific field, with the use of HPC. And specifically, I would love to hear about Piero about the reasons, why the density functional theory, as he says in his abstract, in opposition to the CASSCF and EBPT2. I am sorry if that's not exactly the word. So thank you so much, Piero, again. I don't want to spare more time. So thanks all of you for being here. And Piero, please, the floor is yours. We are looking forward for your talk. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks, Jordi, for that kind introduction. Thank you, everybody, for being here today. Thank you for the opportunity to show my work while I was at the University of Barcelona doing this research. So the idea of this talk is to indeed present the work I did while I was in Barcelona on using multi-configurational calculations to study the spin magnetic order of cobalt clusters, small cobalt clusters. I would like to start mentioning, though, that I am actually an experimental physicist by training. Reason why also I will show in this talk briefly the experimental ways to determine the magnetic order, the spin magnetic order in this type of particles, and why do we need to perform also this type of multi-configurational calculation. So I will talk a little bit of both the experimental side, which is really my training, and the theoretical side. Although my work at Barcelona was purely computational. So that's the idea. Before going into the details, I would like to very briefly introduce you what is, at least to me, a cluster. It has nothing to do with a supercomputer. The idea is that if you think about matter at different length scales, you have on one side what could be the smallest thing you can think of, at least in solid state physics, which is an atom, a nuclei with a bunch of electrons around it. And completely at the other side, you have a bulk material, which is essentially an arrangement of an infinitely large amount of atoms. And somewhere in between, you have a nanoparticle, which will be a system that is composed by a certain number of atoms that gives that particle a size in the range of the nanometers. And the good thing about nanoparticles, why we all like nanoparticles, is that by changing its size, you can tune its physical and chemical response. However, that tuning possibilities with size are rather weak in nanoparticles, in the sense that if you change a little bit the system, let's say you have a nanoparticle of 10,000 atoms or 10,003 atoms, the system will essentially be the same. So the properties will not change. In the cluster size regime, which will be a particle which a size somewhere in between an atom and a nanoparticle, though, the properties change drastically atom by atom. So where really is the separation between what is a cluster or a nanoparticle is a little bit ill-defined, but I would say that a cluster of atoms, which will be a particle composed of a countable number of atoms. So I know exactly how many atoms do I have in my system. And it's in this size regime that properties, all chemical and physical properties, change drastically atom by atom. So the physical and the chemical response of a particle of a cluster of 10 atoms can be completely different from a system with just 11 atoms, so one atom different. So this is an example, a few examples of what I just said, all for gold clusters. So these atoms composed of gold atoms, in which you have very different physical or chemical properties. And in all cases, these properties change drastically atom by atom. So on the left, these are the rates at which gold clusters emit radiation if they are highly excited. So in the y-axis, this is the rate at which they emit photons. They radiate as a function of the number of gold atoms in that particle. And as you see that if you change just by one, the number of atoms, the system will behave completely different. So there is more than one order of magnitude in difference between the radiation rates of a cluster composed of 8 and 9 atoms. So it can be completely different. In the middle is a very different property. So this is the reactivity of these particles, of gold particles, gold clusters, towards carbon monoxide. So it's now a purely chemical property, but still, as a function of size, as a function of the number of atoms in the system, the properties can be completely different. You go from one cluster that is very unreactive towards carbon monoxide to a system that is highly reactive towards this molecule. And then at the right, this is another example. These are optical absorption spectrum of gold clusters. These are the different energies at which these particles can absorb light. You see that if you change a little bit the size of the system, the optical spectra change completely. So in my research, what I do is I try to understand why and how the properties of matter evolve from the atom up to the bulk, going through this cluster size regime in which the properties will evolve atom by atom. So the property I'm interested in today, that was about my work at Barcelona, is the magnetism of these particles. This is the magnetic order these particles have. This is something that has been studied already for quite some time. So these are some experiments, already something like 30 years old. I will explain more in detail how these experiments work in a few slides, but what you see is these are the magnetic moments per atom of two different type of clusters, cobalt and iron, as a function of this number of atoms into the particle. And then you see that also the magnetic order, the magnetic moments can change drastically atom by atom into this system when they are very small, and then they become larger and larger, and the properties tend to evolve towards what you would expect in the bulk. So this is already very interesting because you have the size evolution of the magnetic moments of these materials. And it can be even more puzzling because you can also have systems that behave completely different from what you would expect in the bulk. So for example, these are measurements of magnetic moments of manganese clusters as a function of size. You see this very strong size dependency at the small size range. But surprisingly, this material you expect to be anti-ferromagnetic in the bulk, whereas they are magnetic here when they are small. This is another example in which you expect a paramagnetic behavior in the bulk, which is not the same in the clusters. So the magnetic properties of these particles are very interesting. But then you want to understand, you have this experimental data, and then you want to understand why the system behaved like that as a function of size. And for that, you need to compare these experimental results with calculations. And then you come into some problems. So usually in the cluster community, the theoretical formalism of choice is density functional theory, because it has quite decent, quite high accuracy, this type of calculations, in conjunction with quite low computational cost. So because of that, you can do calculations for relatively large clusters, even hundreds of atoms, you can calculate properties. And you have many properties that DFT can predict very nicely, like the geometries, the reactivity properties. DFT does quite a good job in predicting this. But magnetism has been a long-standing issue. So these experiments that I show are 30 years old, but still today, there is a lot of concern about the predictability of DFT into what is would be the preferred spin magnetic order in these particles. So DFT has quite low predictability for this property in particular. So this is an example of what I just said. So these are example of nickel clusters. So at the top, these are cations, and at the bottom, neutral particles, or the other way around, because I have, the other way around. So you have at the top neutral nickel clusters and at the bottom cations. So the experimental data measuring this type of experiments that we'll describe now are in blue. And then you see the predictions from DFT. What you do there is you calculate the clusters you see using DFT for different spin magnetic orders, and then you see which is the configuration with the lowest energy. And you see that DFT can fail to predict it, underestimate what should be the magnetic order, the spin magnetic moments of these particles. And even for the neutrals, there are calculations at different levels within DFT, and even between them, they don't agree what should be the preferred magnetic order for these systems. Why this happens, why DFT does not predict correctly the magnetic order on these particles, the answers will a little bit depend on who you ask. So an experimentalist will tell you that the theory is just wrong. A computational physicist or chemist will tell you that the experiments make some assumptions that does not allow the calculation to have predictability. So that's why I want to very briefly discuss how these experiments are actually conducted, such that we better understand what are their limitations. There are also limitations in the experiments itself. So there are mainly three ways that you can quantify, that you can get information about these magnetic order of these particles. All of them work in a type of experiments that are called in the gas phase. That means that you produce these particles in a molecular beam that flies within a vacuum chamber at a very high speed, at supersonic speeds. And during flight, you need to come out with an experimental way to detect, to quantify the magnetic order. So one of the main techniques, this is the technique used in the experimental results I showed at the beginning, is called magnetic deflection, which is essentially, if there are physicists in the audience, this is just a Stern and Gerlach magnetic deflection idea. So what you do in this technique, you produce a beam of clusters in a certain way. There are very different ways. You end up with a beam that, as I said, contains clusters of different sizes, different charge states, different compositions, and which are flying in a molecular beam. And then you use a detector to detect these particles. And this detector is position sensitive. That means that you know where these particles are hitting the detector, if they are hitting in the center or on the side. And then during flight, what you do is you place a strong and inhomogeneous magnetic field that you can create by placing there a magnet. And the interaction of that magnetic field with the magnetic moments of these clusters will make the beam to diverge. So to really to change their direction, such that they will hit different places in the detector. And based on these deflections, you can extract information about the magnetic moment of the particle. So here at the right, I have some examples for silver clusters, in which you have in the y-axis is the intensity at the detector as a function of the position in the detector itself in the x-axis. So for systems that are not magnetic, like silver six that has a magnetic spin magnetic moment of spin total spin of zero, if you have or not on your magnet, the beam will always hit more or less at the center of your detector. So here in red is with the magnet on, in blue is with the magnet off. So there's no influence of the magnetic field. But if your system is magnetic, then without the magnets, all your particles hit in the center of the detector. But then when you have the magnet on in red, you have like a splitting of the beam into two different components. And based on this splitting, you can get information about the spin configuration of your clusters. So that's the idea. Now, this technique is quite nice, but it has one complication, not so important, but this technique only works for neutral particles. That's just a detail. But the issue, and this is usually what is used as an argument of why DFT doesn't really compare well with experiments done on this way, is that the deflections, the magnetic deflections, not only depend on the spin configuration, but also on the angular magnetic moments. So this depends on both the spin and the angular magnetic moments as a whole. So you cannot deconvolute the effect from both type of magnetic orders. Whereas DFT usually what is capable to do is to predict what is the most preferred spin configuration. So that's why you will say DFT always underestimate the magnetic moments of clusters investigated in this way, because you're only sensitive to the S part, but not to the L one. Another way to extract information about the magnetic order on the particles is using infrared spectroscopy. This is a technique in which is actually mostly suited to determine experimentally what is the geometry of your particle. What you do is you produce a beam of particles, and then when they are flying in this molecular beam, they interact with a strong laser, and this laser emits photons in the infrared range. And it's that at that energy range that you have the possible vibrational modes of these clusters. So depending on the geometry of the system, if it's planar, if it's three-dimensional, if all the atoms of the cluster are arranged in a line, for example, they will have very different ways of vibrating. And if your laser is in resonance with one of those vibrations, the system will start will absorb that energy, and then you can do some experimental tricks to detect that process. So you end up constructing an experimental infrared spectrum, as in this case, nickel four, in which you see that at a specific energy, the system is absorbing these photons, which means that at that specific energy, the system can vibrate. And the way to detect, to get information about the magnetic moments of the particles, the spin magnetic moments, is that you can be lucky enough that this infrared spectrum is also sensitive not only to the geometry, but to the spin configuration. So what you do is you construct this experimental infrared spectrum as the one in the top, and then you do, for example, DFT calculations for different geometries, for different spin multiplicities, and then you contrast the calculations as the two examples in the bottom with the experiment. Then you say, okay, this cluster is this three-dimensional geometry with a spin multiplicity of four, because that's the one that matches better the experiment. So that's the way it works. The disadvantage of this method is that it heavily relies on theory. So if your theory is not good enough, then it's very difficult to be sure that the information you're extracting is correct. And also you have to be lucky that the spin information actually plays a role in determining the inference. So it's difficult to deconvolute the two effects of geometry and spin state on the system. Sometimes it's not sensitive at all. So then you only know the geometry, but you cannot really say for sure what is this magnetic order of your system. And the final technique is called X-ray magnetic circular diachronism. This is a little bit more difficult to explain, but essentially you produce the beam of particles and then you trap them in an ion trap using some electric field. So they are flying. And then with some electric field, you stop the particles, you confine them. And once they are confined, you let them interact with X-rays. And if these X-rays are right or left polarized, they will interact differently with these particles depending on the total magnetic moment of your system. So you record spectrums of that interaction for both polarizations of the X-rays. And then by comparing that and using some modeling, you can extract information about the spin magnetic moment and the angular magnetic moment. So this technique, which only works for positively charged particles, it's nice in the sense that you can actually deconvolute the effects of both spin and angular magnetic moment, something you cannot do with magnetic deflection, and you don't need to have prior density functional calculations to extract that data. So that information. So this will be kind of the main, the most accurate, the most powerful experimental tool to get information about the magnetism of clusters, even though it doesn't work for neutrons. So that's the idea. Now let's deal a little bit with theory. So usually, as I said, DFT is the method of choice to calculating cluster properties because it's computationally cheap enough that such that you can calculate clusters of even hundreds of atoms. But it has some limitations. So one limitation is what is called that you have to select an exchange and correlation functional. You have to do some approximations in the calculation, and based on these approximations, you can have better or worse agreement with your experimental data. But there is another limitation of this theory that is usually mentioned as something like that you select only a single configuration to describe the state of your system. So I want to very briefly explain what this means with a simplifying example. So let's say you want to calculate a very simple molecule. It's a hydrogen dimer, which is composed of two atoms. So you have two electrons, and these two electrons in this dimer can arrange in two possible energy levels, because you have, when you form this hydrogen dimer, you have what is called the antibonding and the bonding state. And then it's in these two energy levels, which are here represented by these two lines, you have to put your two electrons. So obviously in the ground state, the two electrons will be at the lowest possible energy state. So they will arrange in what is called a configuration like this. You have two states, but the two electrons are in the same state. And that represents the ground state. And DFT works perfectly fine when you try to calculate something like this, because DFT will assume a configuration like this, and then it will run the calculation. But what if you try to calculate what happens if you started dissociating this hydrogen atom? You start pushing farther away and farther away the two atoms till the point that at some point you don't have a molecule, but you have two independent hydrogen atoms. So in that case, what happens is that the more you push away the two atoms, which is now represented here by this coordinate here, this is the distance between the two hydrogen atoms, the two levels will start getting closer and closer in energy. And that happens, and that means that even though in something like this, still the two electrons would prefer to be in this configuration here, both in this level because it's lowest in energy, the energy of the second level, the antibonding one, becomes competitive. So it might be that it's important to describe the state of the system. And then you are really at the dissociation limit, where you actually don't have a bonding and an antibonding state. You really have two degenerate levels, the two 1s levels of the hydrogen atom. And DFT that assumes this single configuration will actually predict a state like this, in which both electrons are in a single state, but that's very far from reality. You expect that at some point you end up with something like what is described at the bottom. Each electron is in one of a specific state. So DFT here is failing to describe something very simple, just a hydrogen dimer, how it's dissociated. And to describe something like that, you really need to take into account the two possible configurations of your system, which will mix up with certain coefficients that will end up being the state of your system. So there is other methods that actually assume many configurations. That's why they're called multi-configurational type of calculations, in which you assume all possible configurations. In this case, you will assume these two configurations here, and then you determine what are the right coefficients such that you minimize the energy of this system. So in the ground state, you will expect that the coefficients are 1 and 0 because you just have this configuration. But in the dissociated limit, you actually have to have a mix up of the two configurations to describe this wave function here. So just to show you some example, I run a multi-configuration calculation of the dissociation of this H2. And then I track, as a function of the separation between the two hydrogen atoms, these two coefficients. And indeed, in the ground state, the coefficients are actually 1 and 0, which means that the state of the system is actually well described by DFT. And that's why the blue and the red curves here, these are the calculations by DFT, and this multi-configurational method, they both agree at the ground state. But then once the system becomes farther and farther away, the two atoms, then your two coefficients are actually 1/√2. So you have to mix up these two configurations. So this will be a limitation when you want to study the magnetism of transition metal clusters, because you have open these shells, you have many possible ways that you can arrange the electrodes of your system. And based on how they are arranged, determine what is the spin magnetic moment of your system. And even though this looks very nice, the problem is that it's extremely computationally demanding. You can express the actual exact solution of the multi-electron Schrödinger equation, which is actually what you want to do, as a linear combination of many possible configurations. So you take all the possible ways you can arrange all your electrons and all the states. Each of those ways of arranging determine one specific configuration, and the exact solution of the problem will be an infinitely large, it's really infinitely large, linear combination of all these possible configurations. But of course, if you want to solve this in a computer, you cannot take an infinitely large sum, so you have to cut somehow. And even if you take a few of these possible configurations, the calculations are very computational demanding, both in computer time and in storage. So this is a method that you can really only do for very small, very specific systems. To make it a little bit more easy, in the method that is the one that I'm describing now, this CASSCF method, what you do is that you don't take all possible configurations, but you separate all your possible states into three categories. You will have in your system, so you have different energy levels, which are here exemplified by these blue lines. And then you have a certain amount of electrons that you have to put there in all the possible configurations. So you will have, in this method, you will define empty states, which you will not treat explicitly because there are no electrons there. Then you also have what is called the inactive states, which will be states that will be doubly occupied. So then you don't have different ways to arrange the electrons in this configuration. So you also don't treat them in a multi-configurational way. And then you have your active orbitals. These will be the orbitals that you will really start playing, that you will actually start playing with the possible ways you can arrange your electrons in them. So this selection of these active orbitals, the more you take, the more computationally demanding your calculation will be. And the complication of this method, which is different from DFT, is that you have to define yourself, not the program itself, not the software that you use to calculate this. You have to select which of the possible states of your system will be active and inactive. And that selection can change quite a lot on your final result. So you have to be very careful in selecting the right active space such that your method actually approaches reality. And even in this case that you are selecting some few configurations to really treat them in a linear combination like this, the method is still really computationally demanding. You can calculate based on just combinatorial problem. If you have a certain number of electrons arranged in a certain total spin and distributed in a certain number of orbitals, how many configurations you actually have. And this will be the number that you will have to put in your linear combination, and then you need to find this coefficient. So the more you have, the more demanding is your calculation. And this number of configurations grows very rapidly with this number. So this is an example of taking a few numbers from this expression. If you have a total spin of 0, so all the electrons are pair, and then you have 6 electrons distributed in a different number of orbitals, how fast it grows the number of configurations that you need to describe your system. So because of this, this type of calculations are the limit to usually something, it depends on your computer, of course, and the size of your system, but something like having 20 electrons distributed in maybe 15 or 16 orbitals, that's the highest you can do. So something like this, when you have 20 electrons in 15 orbitals and a total spin of 3, gives you already this number of configurations that you have to put into the linear combination to describe your system. So, and this rapidly grows. So this method will only be possible to do it for very small clusters. So cobalt or cobalt by itself as an atom already have 50 electrons and you can only describe up to 20. So you have to be very careful in selecting your active space. So that's the idea. Why we selected cobalt, and I will show you the results in a few slides. We selected cobalt because, so there have been experiments on different type of transition metal clusters. And in many cases, it's well known that DFT will not predict the measured spin configuration. We selected cobalt as a test system for these calculations that we wanted to do because the geometries of adopted by cobalt clusters are known from experiments. So we don't have to play with what will be the arrangements of the atoms itself into this particle. This is something that is known, so we don't have to play with it. And also there are experiments done on the spin magnetic moments of this particle. So we know from experiment both the geometries and what are the preferred spin configurations. So these are the experimental results for that. So at the top in red, the points connected by the line correspond to the measured spin magnetic moments of these clusters. And also in this system, it's well known that DFT will fail to predict. So these here are different predictions from DFT of what should be this spin magnetic moment. So you see that they deviate from what is known experimentally. Not for all sizes, but in many cases, it deviates from what you have measured experimentally. So that's why we selected this system for running our calculations. So let's show a few examples now. This was kind of long introduction of what is the problem at play. So we started doing some sort of kind of a benchmark of the calculations we wanted to do on a simple system. So we took the cobalt ion, just one atom, geometry doesn't play any role. And the system is small enough that in our active space, we can take all the electrons. This is the electronic configuration of the cobalt atom. So we can take all 3D electrons and all 4S electrons into the active space explicitly. This will give you in total 9 electrons minus 1 because the system is a cation, so you lose 1 electron. So this will be a calculation in which in your active space, you have 8 electrons distributed in 6 different possible orbitals, the 5 3D orbitals plus the 4S. And these calculations, some details were done with the Orca 4.1 software package. And here are some of the parameters used for this calculation. So the important thing is that we can check how these orbitals look when you do this calculation. They should look the way you expect they should look for an atom, which is really the case. So you have clearly the 5D orbitals that you expect, and then you have the an S state. So you expect to have this 5D, 3D, and the 4S. And in the lowest spin configuration, the system arranged like this. And the state of the system is mono-configurational. That means that in these many different possible ways that you can arrange the electrons, all the coefficients in the linear expansion will be 0, except for 1, which is the configuration that you have here. That's why this configuration takes 100% of the state of the system. And then you can compare the total energy of calculations like this by using the different spin multiplicities. So in this plot here, I will explain it a little bit. So in blue, these are the calculations using this CASSCF method. Just realizing now that it's called differently, but that's a detail. So in blue, this will be the energy differences for these three multiplicities in terms of the multiplicity that is known from the experiment. So that means that the multiplicity 1 and the multiplicity 5 are higher in energy than what is known experimentally, which will be the multiplicity 3. So indeed, we can say here that CASSCF is correctly predicting the preferred spin orientation, the preferred spin configuration of these particles as what is measuring experimentally. We also, for comparison, we run calculations using DFT. So all the other bars, all the other colors represent DFT calculations using different exchange and correlation functionals, these approximations you have to do in this method. We selected these five because they are all quite different in nature. So we took a GGA, a meta-GGA, two hybrids, and one long-range corrected hybrid functionals. In this case, that the system is monoconfigurational, we expect that DFT will also be able to predict correctly the measure spin configuration, because all these DFT methods will assume this configuration in the calculation. And indeed, you see that indeed all the DFT calculations are predicting the triplet state as the lowest energy. So once we have this benchmark, we understand that this seems to work. So we move to the more complicated system. So we increase its size, and with that, we increase the size also of our active space. So the calculations become much more difficult. You have to nicely select your active space and much more computationally demanding. So in the left are the results, similar results, but now for the cobalt dimer. And in this case, still taking all the D and the S electrons of cobalt is feasible. So this will mean an active space of 17 electrons distributed in 12 orbitals, something we can still do at Mare Nostrum 4. Differently from the cobalt ion, now this dimer is actually multi-configurational. So you see all these different configurations at the left. With certain coefficients that span, if you normalize them, these percentages of the total state of the system. But even though it is multi-configurational, there is one configuration that sort of dominates over the other. And then we compare the results for three different multiplicities. The measured one always in these plots is the one in the center, so it's a multiplicity of six. And then if you calculate four and six using CASSCF, you see that these two states are also much higher in energy, so you would predict correctly the measured multiplicity for this dimer. If you do DFT, here also works. So you see that all the DFT methods are also correctly predicting. So even though the wave function of the system is multi-configurational, all these DFT methods are assuming the dominant configuration. Also, the system is simple enough such that it works. And this was also something known in the previous results that I showed. So up to three, DFT is known to correctly predict the spin configuration of these systems. Then we calculated the tree, cobalt tree. And in this case, we had to stop taking all D and S electrons of the system. If you will do that, that will mean an active space of 26 electrons distributed in 18 orbitals, which means something like, what is this number? Something like 6 million configurations that you have to take in your linear combination. And then you have to optimize the coefficients of all those configurations. So it becomes simply impossible. I actually tried to calculate this in the supercomputer, but the calculation didn't even start. It just said, no, forget about it. I will not even try to do it. So we had to remove a few doubly occupied states, take them out from the active space into the inactive space. But this has to be carefully done. You cannot just randomly start taking out orbitals. So before you have to do maybe some preliminary DFT calculations to really understand more or less how these electrons could be organized, and then you select your active space. So in this case, we remove three doubly occupied orbitals. And so we end up in a CASSCF calculation of 20 electrons distributed in 15 orbitals, which is quite large, but manageable. And then if you calculate the state of the system is mostly monoconfigurational. You have one very dominant configuration into the system. A few others with very little percentage, some very tiny coefficients there that are not strictly zero. And again, CASSCF here in blue is correctly predicting the spin configuration that is measured in the experiment, because the other two states, so the measured multiplicity is seven, and the other states five and nine are much higher in energy. And also DFT works here, which you will actually expect because the system is mostly monoconfigurational. So all these DFT calculations are assuming this configuration for the multiplicity seven. And so it seems to work. But then we end up into the size that we were expecting to have problems with DFT, because this was known from previous studies. Now, if you will try to calculate cobalt 4 and take all the DNS electrons, that will mean 35 electrons in 24 orbitals. That's a number of configurations of what is this? It's an extremely large number, so this is obviously impossible. So in this case, we had to remove two doubly occupied orbitals per cobalt atom, ending up in an active space of 19 electrons distributed in 16 orbitals. And a calculation like this for the measured multiplicity, which is 10, shows that actually the state, the wave function of the system is highly multi-configurational. You have three dominant configurations and many others with decent percentage. And you have actually two of very similar percentage, two possible configurations. And a calculation like this, a CASSCF calculation, again, will predict correctly the measured state. Although 8 is not so much higher in energy, still it predicts that the lowest spin configuration, the lowest in energy, is the measured one in the experiment, so the multiplicity 10. And then if you go to DFT, then you end up in a mess, because now you see some bars pointing down, which means that depending on the functional you select, the system will predict either the multiplicity 8 or the multiplicity 12. So for example, PVEs, it's predicting that the system should be in a multiplicity 8, whereas B3LIP, it predicts the 12. So now, depending on the functional, you will have different predictabilities. And surprisingly, none of the functionals we selected predict the measured spin multiplicity for this system. But CASSCF does, so that's a nice thing. Why you have this functional dependence? You can look into the electronic structure of this cluster calculated by the different functionals, which is more or less what you get here. And then you see the important thing here is that, so this will be the electronic structure calculated with PVE and PVE0, which are actually different. So you are actually converging, you're actually assuming, depending on the functional, one of these two different configurations, which is why, depending on the functional you take, you have different predictions of what should be the corresponding spin state, because both the different functionals will not agree what is the configuration of the system. And so DFT loses its predictability. We also tried to calculate cobalt five, but this was really at the limit of what the computer could do. And now the results, actually, we have to be quite careful in understand them, in analyze them. If you will take all DNS electrons, this will mean 35 electrons in 24 orbitals. So it's something like 4 to the power of 11 configurations that you will have to take. This is simply impossible. So we had to remove many electrons here. That's why we have to be quite careful. So it's really on the edge of what CASSCF can do. So by doing that, we end up in a configuration of 16 electrons in 15 orbitals. This was the highest the supercomputer could do. And even in that case, we cannot calculate all the possible multiplicities of the system. So because the lowest the multiplicity is, the highest the number of configuration, the more ways you can arrange these electrons. So we could only calculate the multiplicities 11, 13, and 15 using this active space. Luckily, the 13 is the one measured in the experiment, so we can still check the measured one with the two next to them to it, but still we cannot calculate them all. If you do that, the state around the measured multiplicity, the 13 is not super multi-configurational, but the 11 is. So, and then you need to compare the energies of all the possible multiplicities. So you will also expect some problems with DFT. CASSCF can actually predict correctly the measured value. And DFT does a better job than for cobalt 4, which actually makes sense because now this state here is mostly monoconfigurational, but still some functionals predict the 11 as the lowest in energy. So still DFT runs into trouble. And unfortunately, this was the largest size we could calculate for this system. So with that, I wanted to conclude. So just some general thoughts about this study. So I show you that the magnetism at the nanoscale is very rich with magnetic orders that depend strongly on the size of your system and vary for system to system. And sometimes this magnetic order can be very different from what you expect in the bulk. Density functional theory is typically the method of choice, and you can understand why, because it does very well for certain properties, geometries, reactivities, even sometimes optical absorptions are quite well calculated with this method, but it's not always the case. So for magnetism, it's known to have quite some problems to describe transition metal clusters in particular. Cobalt clusters were used as a test to try to calculate the spin configuration of these particles using now multi-configurational calculations, CASSCF method. And we see that this method can actually predict for all the sizes we study from the atom up to five, the measured magnetic order of the system. So we can more or less say that maybe this will at least help in solving a long-standing question of why theoretical calculations fail to explain, to correlate with the experimental results on the magnetic order of these particles. So the idea will be to extend these calculations to other transition metal clusters, but the drawback will for now always be that you can only calculate very small systems. So I would also like to help my financial agency here in Belgium and also the HPC3. I've actually done two research stages with this grant, so I have to be very grateful to it. Also the people in the Barcelona Supercomputer Center and my host at the University of Barcelona and a researcher, a PhD student from King's College London that was also a much help with this calculation. And with that, I would like to thank your attention and ask if you have any questions.
Thank you, Piero. Thank you so much for this very nice talk. I would just give the floor to the attendees. If anyone has any question, we may use the audio on, or you may ask any question through chat, whatever you feel. Meanwhile, I have Peter. I have a question. You talk at the beginning, no? That you are more like an experimental scientist right now instead of,
yes. Yeah.
I would say, a simulation or HPC scientist, no? But do you think? I mean, do you think these are two sides? I mean, are there two sides of the same scientist, or whether you are focusing on experimental science, you are not able to really focus on HPC, on simulation work? What is your feeling about that? I mean, because sometimes it feels like it's like this kind of duplicity, it's difficult.
Yes. Yeah, it's indeed difficult. I do believe that an integrated scientist should be try to both do both or understand both. That's what I try to do. So nowadays, I think I split my time really half and half on doing experiments. I still go to the lab every week. And I still, every day I run calculations, not at the BSC anymore, but at the supercomputer here in Belgium. But yeah, it needs a lot of time because you really need to understand both. But my stronger suit is definitely the experimental side. So for example, I'm very bad at working in the command prompt and stuff like that. So I'm always having issues with it. But yeah, I think ideally you will have to, in my opinion, you should be able to do both a little bit. Of course, you need to be an expert in something, no? So I would say I'm more an expert in the experimental side. And there's people that are really experts on calculations and they know stuff that I will never understand, but yeah.
Well, in any case, that's why research groups are for, no? I mean,
so collaboration, it's really important. Yeah.
That's how really science progress, not
yes.
in individual basis, but in a group basis.
Yes. This idea of the scientists like completely isolated, that's not true anymore. I mean, you need to collaborate. Yeah, indeed.
I just wanted to, before I have another question and some comments, but before that, before we close, is there any question from the audience? Some, I don't see any raised hand or any questions in the chat. Because here from the program, we are really so happy to see the progress of our fellow of our fellows here, I mean, of our people that are granted. So we feel really, you know, very enthusiastic about your progress in your and your and your career, in your professional career, in your professional life. So that's why we really hope that the program has helped a little bit in your future. As a
definitely, yeah. As I said, this is my second HPC 3 grant.
That's good. And there's another thing that if you want, because I mean the access to supercomputing in here in Barcelona in the BSC, it's gone through different ways, different channels. One is the one that you just said, the HPC Europa program for linked to this mobility program, but there is also an access through the Spanish supercomputing network. So whether any one of you in your research activities want to apply to access for the RES, it's called the RES in Spanish, the Red Española Supercomputación, Spanish Supercomputing Network. There's like competitive calls. There are three every year. It's open to all scientists, of course, in Europe and maybe, but mainly in Europe, but also internationally, but mainly in Europe, of course. And you are free and you are more welcome to apply for that. So if you have any more information, you just email me or you just type res.es and you have all the information. Well, if there is no more questions, just would like to close and thanks again to Piero. Thanks for your really very interesting presentation and I think you really explain it, even for me that I am not in this field. I really understood most of the ideas. So thank you so much. Thank you so much, Piero.
Thank you too.
Thanks for the attendees, because I think that we are starting running this type of series from HPC Europa fellows here in Barcelona, in Spain at least. So we will surely in a short time organize the next one, and I hope you will participate in that either as a speaker or as an attendee.
So great. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Pedro. Thanks all. And nice to see you, and bye bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.